So, students, we are going to start our next topic of our welding and joining chapter, which is welding quality. And the video details are in the file Learning Material Video Weld Quality Defects and Inspection, part number F. So, let us take a look at different types of defects which are formed during the welding process. And number one defect is residual stresses and distortion. So what happens is that when you do welding process, then basically you apply heat, and when you apply heat, then it causes the material to shrink or contract. Okay, so when due to the difference in heat, this region is cold, this region is hot. So hot regions wants to expand, cold region wants to contract. So then what? So rapid heating and cooling in localized region results in thermal expansion. So in small localized region, there is a heat gradient where the temperature is high in the region where melting is occurring. So here the temperature T is very high, and in the corner region the temperature is comparatively lower. Hence the plate wants to shrink or contract. So residual stresses causes distortion. So the distortion can be like this, something like this, angular distortion. It can be like in one direction only as well, okay, depending on the joint type. So there are different types of distortion. And warping means that there is displacement on one corner, then there is another displacement in this direction on another corner, then we've got another displacement in this direction. So there is like a small sheet. For example, this is a piece of paper and then it has warped. So this is called warpage. So we move on to how can we minimize this warping and distortion. So perhaps we can fix these ends by using a fixture. I can fix these ends, or I can use a clamp, okay, and I can fix these ends. And when I'm going to hold something tightly, then it will prevent warping or distortion. So this is called physically restraining something. I can use heat sinks, so I can attach a cold plate beneath. Okay, this cold plate will help remove the high temperature quickly so that there is no distortion due to thermal stresses. Next, I can do tack welding. What is tack welding? Tack welding is that I have got one plate and then I've got another plate which I want to weld. Then what I will do is I will just do one point welding on one corner, and then I will do one point welding on another corner, so that I have joined these plates together and then I have aligned them. Then later on I will carry out the welding in any of the direction that I want to carry out. So these corners, these small dots or points are called tack, TACK, tack welds. Select proper welding conditions. So I have got my equipment which is attached, so it has got current, ampere, voltage, okay. So I need to select and carefully increase or decrease voltage and current according to my specification of welding. So the base material can be preheated, so I can also increase the temperature of the whole plate. So by increasing the temperature of the whole plate, I am reducing the difference between melting point and the temperature of the base material, so that when during welding the melting occur, then there is less physical shock. So I can increase the temperature by using a blow torch, by using a torch gun. I can heat the plate and then do welding. Stress relief heat treatment can be performed. So after, you know, I have done the welding, what I will do is I will put my welding specimen into a furnace. So this is a furnace. In this furnace there is some amount of retained temperature or regulated temperature. I will put my sample inside the furnace so that I can heat it and relieve the stresses. And proper design of weldment is also necessary. So these are the techniques by which we can improve the welding quality by minimizing warping and distortion. Next, there is another type of defect called cracks. Cracks are called fracture type interruptions. So basically you have got a plate and then there is some kind of a fracture type interruption. So this is called crack in the weld or base metal. So the crack can occur in the base metal. So this is the base metal where we have got the plate. We have got two base metal number one and base metal number two. And then we have got the weld, which is called W. So the crack can occur on the base metal and on the weld. it causes significant reduction in strength. So if I'm going to do the tensile testing and I check sigma UTS, okay, then it will reduce because there is crack which is present. It causes embrittlement by low ductility of weld or base metal combined with high restraint during contraction. So during contraction, during distortion also, what happens is that different amount of stresses causes expansion or contraction of the weld, which causes the cracks to open up or ripen up. So these are some of the things which causes cracks to occur. So as you can see here, we have got different cracks which appear in this figure. Here transfer crack example is presented, where the crack is in the transverse direction. Okay, here we have got a longitudinal crack which is in the direction of weld. You can see that the direction is in the direction of the welding. We have got toe crack. So the region which attaches to this part is called toe. So it is called toe crack. And then under bead crack means that these are the weld beads. Okay, so below this there is a crack and that is called under bead crack. So these are the various types of cracks which are present. Next we move on to cavities and porosities. The cavities or porosity consist of small voids, cavity or empty space. So let's say this is a plate and I have done welding. This is the weld bead. Okay, so what happens is that some air bubbles are trapped inside and these are called cavities or porosities. Okay, porosity is due to the entrapped gas. So there is basically in this region, if I zoom inside, then there is gases which are gas molecules or particles are entrapped or trapped. Porosity usually results from inclusion from atmospheric gases. So during welding, basically we have got this molten pool and it is in liquid form. So the air from the atmosphere, okay, oxygen air comes inside and it gets trapped. Sulfur in the weld metal or contaminants on the surface can also come. So if you got some contaminants, they can also jump inside the melt pool and then they can trap inside. Another type of cavity is called shrinkage void, and a cavity which is formed due to shrinkage during solidification is called shrinkage cavity. So when the whole base material wants to shrink in this direction, okay, then what happens is that some cavities are also formed and this is called shrinkage solidification cavity. There is another thing called solid inclusion. Any non-metallic solid material which is trapped in the weld metal, such as slag inclusion. So as you know that during welding we use a filler and that filler has got some flux. When the flux burns, okay, this is the flux coating and this is my electrode and this is also a filler material that I want to deposit on my plate. So during welding what happens is that the flux also is detached or burns and it is deposited onto the weld, okay, in the form of slag. Now this slag can also drop inside my weld pool. So this is a molten weld pool. This flux or these flux particles can also get trapped inside in the form of slag and they can become solid inclusion. Okay, so this is a solid particle which is trapped in my weld bead. Okay, for this welded plate. So we have got cavities, we have got porosity, we have got shrinkage voids, we have got solid inclusion and we have got slag inclusion in the form of slag. Next we move on to another type of defect called incomplete fusion. So during welding process, if you don't provide enough current and enough voltage, then what happens is that you do not achieve enough temperature. When you do not achieve enough temperature, then enough melting does not occur. When enough melting does not occur, then what happens is that some of the part is not joined and it is unmelted. Unmelted portion is not joined and it remains a cavity. So this place where there is lack of join, there is no melting which occur, is called incomplete fusion. It is also called lack of fusion. It is also called lack of penetration. So for instance, I have got these two plates, okay, and I did not provide enough current and voltage, then only this part is welded. Okay, and the remaining portion is empty. So this is called lack of penetration. It means that the welding did not penetrate it completely until the base metal. Okay, so it should in actual case it should look like that it has completely penetrated the weld metal or base metal, actually base metal 1 and base metal 2, and this is weld metal. So So this is, should be the actual condition. So we do not want incomplete fusion. We do not want lack of fusion. We do not want lack of penetration. We want full fusion, full penetration of the weld material. Next, we move on to imperfect shape or unacceptable contour. So usually if the profile is very good, then the weld bead should look like this, okay, just like a cone. However, if you see that you have got some material which has been removed from the sideways, then this is called undercut defect. If the weld bead looks like this, then it means that there is less material in the middle, which means this is underfill. What happens is that the total dimension or total length of the or width or thickness of the base material has reduced. Previously it was very large, you can see the base material thickness is very large, but now it has reduced. If you look again, if you do over welding, it means you put too much material, then what happens that is that it will overlap and it will be deposited on the sideways as excess penetration or excess weld. So these are some of the three types of defect which are due to contour, and contour mean the shape. The perfect shape is a cone. However, if there is changes in the shape, then there is problem in the contour, which means unacceptable contour, and it could be undercut, underfill or overlap. So this was all about different types of defects which are formed, and now we are going to move on to inspection and testing methods. So now let us take a look at the inspection and testing methods which are used. So when we do welding process, okay, then it is important for us to see what is the quality that we have made, what kind of quality it is, does it have any kind of defects, is there any underfill or undercuts which are present, okay, are there any cracks. So in order to examine, in order to test whether these cracks and defects are present, we need to go through quality control measures, and to judge the quality, integrity and property of our welding, we need to do some testing. We need to carry out some dimensional procedures, whether this dimension is correct or not, and whether there is some kind of angular misfit, something like that. So number one thing is visual inspection. You see through your own eyes how the welding looks like. Okay, if you have got a plate, then you can see whether there are some cracks which are present. Okay, you can use some chemicals to further visualize the cracks. You can use some visual testing to see how it conforms to the dimensional specification, whether the penetration depth is complete, whether there is complete gap between the roots, something like that. Is there any warping? Is there any cracks, defects, cavities, incomplete fusions, inclusions, slag inclusions which are present? So internal defects such as anything which is inside the weld cannot be seen because it is hidden. So in order to check, we need to use some other testing methods to check the internal defects which occur. But everything which is on the external or over the exterior is something that we can check correctly. So one of the most important things is that we need to follow the procedure. And following the procedure is one of the most important thing to do for welding. Procedure should be followed before welding, during welding and after the welding process. So what should be the procedures? We will read out carefully. The material should be welded and related to the standards, American Society of Mechanical Engineers, American Standard Testing Material, etc. So my material should be according to the specification. Then we should have welder qualification certificate. So there are some certificates, okay, which qualifies a welder or a person to do the job, to carry out the welding process. So that certificate should be given, should the welder have, and that with that certificate only the welder can perform the welding operation. Welding equipment and electrodes, including storage and drying system, should be prepared. They should be well maintained. Welding edge preparation and correct beveling should be done. So usually when you have got a plate, then you need to prepare some of the edges. So what you need to do, you need to sometime bevel the edges, okay, this is called beveling. You can see that there is some angle or some chamfer which is given, okay. So this helps in basically depositing the weld material more correctly and more easily. So beveling can be done, then correct beveling angle should be given, so there should be correct angle. Clearance of the backing strip or ring should be given. So sometimes what you do is you put a backing plate so that there is good alignment. So this is something that should be given. Overall alignment and fit up should be carried out. So the welding should be fixed, it should be fitted, okay, it should be clamped correctly so that the welding is done according to the procedure. Then what should be done during the welding? During the welding, the preheat and interpass temperature should be given. So let's say you've got a weld bead, then you're going to use a gas torch to preheat the material, and then during welding also, if you want, then you can give the heating, and that is called interpass temperature heating. You should clean up the weld, you should do chipping, grinding and guffing, because when you do the welding process, okay, then there is some extra material which is present on the top and on the bottom. So you need a grinding machine, okay, and that grinding machine should be used to level the surface and to smoothen out and to improve the surface finish of the weld. Structural defects and discontinuity should be avoided. Then after the welding, dimensional accuracy of the weldment should be checked using fillet weld gauges. So basically there are different types of gauges which are present, okay. I can use these gauges to basically check how my weld looks like, okay. So this gauge can help me determine whether my weld is according to the dimension or not. Conformity to the drawing should be done also. So if let's say a welder has given a drawing that these parts should be welded in this direction, in this position with some welding symbols, then we need to confirm our welding according to the drawing which was given by the engineer. Acceptability of the welds with regards to appearance and fabrication quality, this should be checked. Then the presence of any unfilled crater, undercuts, cracks and overlap should be checked on the surface. During before welding, we should do is we should carry out welding joint preparation. So basically I've got this plate, okay. So first thing I need, or first step I need to take, is I need to clean the surface. Then the portion of the base metal to which the ground clamp will be attached must be clean. So I need to basically clamp, okay, or I need to basically hold this plate. So that portion where I'm going to hold, I should clean that area also. Poor contact with the ground clamp will create resistance in the welding circuit and could result in poor weld quality. So when you do welding, basically there is something called grounding, where you want the current, basically when the current is coming, okay, onto the plate, then it should go out and it should be earthed properly, okay. So that is called grounding clamp. So that grounding clamp should be clean, otherwise the current will not pass, okay. And poor contact with the ground clamp will create resistance in the welding circuit. So there will be a resistance which will be created if the ground clamp is not corrected, it is not connected properly, and this will result in poor welding quality. Now what are the different types of testing which can be done to see the cracks which are inside the weld? Okay, I need to see the cracks which are inside the weld. So number one is non-destructive evaluation. We have got 1, 2, 3, and 4 types. Number one is dye-penetrant test. Dye-penetrant test and fluorescent-penetrant test are the method for detecting very small defects such as cracks and cavities. Magnetic particle testing is also a different type of testing in which we use magnetic particles, because they gather around a defect. They can gather around a defect and they will pinpoint that this is the place where there is some type of defect present. But magnetic particle testing is only limited to ferromagnetic material only. A magnetic field is established at the subject part. The magnetic particles are sprinkled on the surface. The subsurface defects such as crack, inclusion can be detected as the magnetic particles are concentrated in that region. Okay? So the magnetic particle will go towards that region and they will pinpoint that, okay, this is the place where crack is present. Next, we go on to ultrasonic testing. So ultrasonic testing is basically the use of high frequency sound waves, and they, with the help of sound waves, we can detect whether there is some kind of discontinuity which is present. So I've got a crack, okay, and I'm going to put my detector here, then it will produce some types of amplitude in the frequency spectrum. Okay, so using this amplitude, I can determine the size of the crack also, and the location or the distance from the transducer to the cracking area. Then we got radiography testing. Radiography means using radioactive material. By using radioactive material, okay, such as different types of compounds such as they are basically covered in lead, such as radium. Okay, so these are some of the radioactive compounds. They can basically penetrate the material, and then I can put a film inside. Okay, so where there is less penetration, it will show some kind of contrast on my X-ray film. So using X-ray or gamma radiation, I can detect whether there is some type of crack present or not. So this was all about non-destructive testing, in which I do not crack or I do not destroy the sample. There is another type of testing called destructive testing, in which I will basically destroy the sample to check the strength of the material. For instance, you guys have already seen that we do tensile testing, in which we have this two plates which are welded together, and then I'm going to clamp them on a universal tensile testing machine, and then I'm going to apply the force. When a force is applied, then there will be a crack, and then I will be able to know what is the sigma weld strength of the material. Okay, so we can do tensile testing, we can do hardness testing, we can do mechanical testing. These are different types of mechanical testing which can be carried out. We can also do peel testing, in which we can peel a material. Okay, what you do is we apply peel force and we peel the material, something like that. So this is peel testing. So these are different types of mechanical testing. Another thing is metallurgical testing. In metallurgical testing, we examine the features such as metallic structure, defects, extent, condition of heat affected zone, and the presence of other elements and similar phenomena. So what I will do for doing the metallurgical testing is I will cut a very small sample. When I will cut the very small sample, I have got a very small sample, then I am going to mount it in a plastic, then I am going to do grinding and polishing, then I am going to put it in under the view of a microscope. Okay, and by looking at the microscope under illuminated light, I will see what is the microstructure of the material, how large are the grains, how much is the heat affected zone, what is the fusion zone. These are different information that we can obtain when we do metallurgical test. So mechanical testing can be tensile shear test. Okay, this is tensile shear test. Number two is fillet break test. We got a fillet welding, as you can see in the joint types. Fillet welding is one in which we do a welding for a perpendicular plate. So this is the fillet weld. So we've got a testing for checking the fillet welding, which is called fillet break test. Then we have got tensile shear test. Okay, this is a tensile shear testing. And then we've got peel testing for spot welds. So different types of mechanical tests are used and metallurgical tests are used, which are a part of destructive testing. So this was all about the end of your course and the end of manufacturing technology, chapter number welding. So wishing you very good luck, and see you in the next semester. Thank you.